Good evening. I'd like to call the Village Board Committee of the Whole meeting for May 20th, 2019 to order and ask Clerk Turner to call the roll.
Mayor Pisak?
Here.
Trustee Carvalho?
Here.
Trustee Kowitzel?
Here.
Trustee Dixit?
Here.
Trustee Hasse?
Here.
Trustee Sadat?
Here.
Trustee Winds?
Here.
Is there anyone present here tonight to provide public comment? If so, please come on down to the podium.
So I usually don't come up and say anything. I'm more the wallflower in our relationship.
I'm sorry, please state your name for the record.
I'm Raza Siddiqui. And basically, I wanted to come up because I had a very enjoyable experience a few weeks ago to take part in the Police and Public Works open house. It's something that anytime I feel like the children will forego playing video games and come out and actually have an experience where they get to enjoy what our village has to offer, I think it's important to acknowledge the people that made it work. And I wanted to thank the people who put it on for making it such an enjoyable experience. I gotta say, just as a guy who's middle-aged, to see detectives who try to solve crimes, teaching children what it is they do and how fingerprinting works, and seeing that inspiration in their eyes, it just makes me proud to be a Lisle resident, and I want to thank everyone who made that happen.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Hearing none, we'll move on to presentations. First item on our agenda is Economic Development Incentive Policy. Would Village Manager Ertmode please provide an overview of this item?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Good evening, everyone, again. I think this, Mayor, this conversation this evening segue very well into your comments at the Village Board meeting regarding economic development. This is a conversation that actually started this past summer during the Village Board's strategic initiatives process. And one of those key areas that the board wanted to focus on over the next 3 years was quality economic development. And one of those initiatives that were identified to support this area is the development of an economic incentive policy that's sustainable and provides for sufficient economic incentive to encourage desired growth. And again, that is directly from the board's key strategic performance focus areas that were approved at the first of the year. To that end, beginning in March 2019, the Village's Economic Development Commission and staff reviewed some best practice recommendations from the Government Finance Officers Association for establishing an economic development incentive policy, as well as multiple examples from other Illinois towns. Really, the purpose of this policy is intended to provide guidance and direction to the development community, as well as to develop an internal framework for the evaluation of these incentive requests, and include the following points that have been outlined in the policy. First, it establishes the village's economic development goals, of which are outlined in the draft policy dated May 14th. That is in the first section after the introduction, and that goes through some draft and recommended economic development goals, and then identifies some other considerations. The policy also identifies the types of incentives by sub areas. So specifically, what incentives are we looking at for the downtown, the Ogden, and the Warrenville corridor? So that is identified as attachment one in the draft policy. Again, the sub areas, retail, commercial, office corridors are identified: Ogden Avenue, Illinois Route 53, Maple Avenue, and Warrenville Road. Some of those possible incentive tools are identified as property tax abatements, sales tax rebate agreements, special service areas, business districts, utility tax extension agreements, or TIF areas. And then in the downtown, in this downtown area, we've drawn in the definition that's identified in the downtown master plan as identifying the downtown area. And in there, we identify some possible incentive tools: property tax abatements, sales tax rebate agreements, special assessment areas, business districts, utility extension agreements, as well as TIF. And there is a portion of downtown that is an existing TIF. Beyond that, we do outline a review standards and process, And most importantly, at the end of the policy is a performance standards and a clawback provisions that would be included in any sort of incentive agreement. And again, as the board is aware, there was a recent agreement that was approved with Westside Tractor. This criteria, this policy would be used as a benchmark and used as guidance for staff, the EDC, as well as the village board when we look at approving future incentive agreements. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions, but I would again like to acknowledge the work that the EDC put forward in this effort to come forward with this recommended policy.
Thank you, Village Manager Ertmode. Is there any public comment regarding this item? Seeing none, any board members have any questions?
I too would like to compliment the EDC on the work on this. There's some great, very appealing language and goals and objectives herein. Is it the intention that these incentives be funded by the hotel motel tax funds exclusively?
So I think that's probably our second item tonight. These items in this incentive policy, the overall incentive policy, relates to sales tax, and it would be, I don't think that would be funded by hotel motel tax. These would be sales tax abatements or TIFs, those types of incentives. The next item for the committee to review are a couple of grant programs, and currently those grant programs are funded, a restaurant grant, those sales tax are retail incentives, those are currently funded through hotel motel.
So currently, well, I mean, I know we'll get to that next,
right?
But currently, would they be expected to continue to be exclusively from that?
No, that would be identified in the budget process,
Okay.
those funding mechanisms.
And I wanted some clarification regarding the clawback.
Yes.
What would trigger it? How would it be enforced?
So it would be enforced as part of the agreement. I think we wanted to put, although it didn't get specific, the specifics would be included in whichever agreement the village board decided to enter into with that third party. So we have some clawback provisions currently in the Westside Tractor deal that was most recently approved. But this policy just identifies that yes, any agreement that the village would be considering would contain a clawback provision. Oh, there's nothing specific in the policy identifying what that would be. I think
case
that would need
case.
To be negotiated.
And was it in here? I think I read and really appreciated, wherever I read it, I really appreciated that the village would not waive impact fees.
That's in this policy.
Correct. I think that's excellent.
Eric, I had a question for you.
Yes.
There is I really like the fact that you included the performance standards. I was wondering, is there a way to also include regular statuses on development as an ongoing portion of this performance standards, just to measure them?
Yes, and I think that would be identified in two places, probably in the review standards as well as the clawback and performance standards. So that would be included in probably both efforts. And so whether that's regular construction updates, that can definitely be included in future agreements. I think the current Westside agreement does include statuses as requested by the village.
It does.
So that's we would carry that over.
Okay.
Who would be responsible for reviewing those? Would that fall onto the EDC or would that be a staff?
Reviewing
performance.
Performance. Mm-hmm. That would be staff. So once an agreement was put in place, the agreement is between the developer, the business, and the village board. Staff would be responsible for identifying any sort of performance shortfalls and working with the village attorney to identify any sort of breaches of that provision regarding performance.
Would that be something out of the village manager's office or development services then specifically?
We would probably act as a team in that effort. So
okay, thank you.
So, for instance, with this, like, let's say we had a developer came in and wanted to develop Family Square. This is something that could be applied in that a new redevelopment agreement could involve some sort of a clawback in this to assure that we don't have the problems that we faced here.
Absolutely. This would identify kind of the basic framework of those incentives. Staff, the village attorney, and the developer would operate off of this, and this is where we would provide direction to the developer and the business, and then we would bring that forward through the EDC process and then to the village board to review.
This really assists us in negotiations by having this adopted policy that the developers can see ahead of time. They're going to know what's expected from them.
Mm-hmm. Would it be similar to other local municipalities?
Yes.
Because I in my talking with people, there's sometimes talk that Lisle can be difficult to work with, and I don't understand necessarily how that comes about, but I want to make certain that we're doing our best to eliminate that reputation any way we can.
Since I represent other municipalities, I can tell you that these provisions, especially for TIF and redevelopment agreements, are very common. Sure, and I'm not surprised that people would complain, but they're common.
Well, I'm not opposed to it. I mean, I definitely want to see some sort of teeth to a contract that will assure that we don't, that we can recoup some of our expenses during delayed construction. But at the same time, I don't want to cause some sort of a deterrent to anybody to develop.
I would tell you also that TIF consultants would generally recommend these provisions as well. And
perfect.
Can tell you that they're pretty standard.
And when the EDC and staff looked at these, you know, this we didn't start from scratch here. We modeled off of other municipalities and taking provisions from other policies that they have.
And I can tell you from participating in meetings with interested parties, developers, people that own property in Lisle, they don't mind a tough board or a tough village. They just want it predictable, understandable. So our codes, by updating them, our zoning, which we're getting to, getting that up to date, getting this policy established where there was none previously and everything was done ad hoc, that led to uncertainty. Mm-hmm. With this, everybody along the process understands what the policy is, what the criteria are, measurements are, and makes it easier for everybody to get along. I think everybody will be pleased with it.
Could you expound a little on what would this be? This is under performance standards / clawback. The last paragraph, I just want some clarification on this. Incentive agreements will be structured in a manner that allows the village to, I think it means to be the first recipient of revenue generated by a project.
Sure, yes. I apologize for that typo there. But again, this is, I would draw your attention back to the West Side Agreement where the village receives the first $100,000 of that sales tax. So again, this is the village would be paid first before there's any sort of sharing.
And earlier it was mentioned about developer impact fees. In conversations with the fire district, as our development needs are changing, we're no longer expanding, we're infilling and developing vertically, developing for an aging population with different types of developments. The needs of the fire district and their impact is different, but they're not one of the bodies considered in impact fees. Do we have the legal ability to impose impact fees for fire district concerns?
As non-home rule, I'm not sure that we have that authority under the state statute. And assuming that at some point in time that we may become home rule, then I think we would have that authority.
And in our code, we call them contributions and not impact fees. So I think that's
right. Probably
where the difference is. So I don't know if could we add the fire district as a recipient of developer contributions in the code, similar to what we have for park sites and library sites?
Right. Well, whether you call them contributions or impact fees, they're covered by the municipal code under the subdivision provisions. And I believe that all the ones that we currently have are the ones that are authorized by, okay, by that provision.
And similar to the parking financing topic of going to referendum, would referendum be an option then, short of home rule, if home rule was either not achieved or was voted out, would referendum be an option to then allow fire district impact fees?
I would have to look into that. I'm not sure. And you can generally go out to referendum to, again, there has to be some authorization in the state statute to allow that. But I mean, that's not to say that, you know, we couldn't seek an amendment to the state statutes to accomplish what we need to do. That's not impossible either. So we have several options. I can put something together and get it to you.
Okay, thank you.
But if we have the contributions or impact fees that we currently do, and we were only home rule for that little bit of time way back, how did we get those?
There are ones authorized in the municipal code, whether you're home rule or not.
It's just that the fire is not one of them.
Right, correct.
Got it, okay.
Okay, any other board member questions? May I have a motion to direct staff to prepare a resolution approving an economic development incentive policy?
So moved.
Second.
You got that recorded?
We do.
Okay. Motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Second item on our agenda, Business Development Grants Program. Would Village Manager Ermode please provide an overview of this item?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. This evening, again, the second item on your committee meeting relates to a proposed guidelines for a revised restaurant grant program, a new retail business build-out program, and a shopping center multi-use retail grants program, and the particular guidelines established. Linking back to the Village's strategic performance areas, quality economic development. We're looking at our grant programs and looking at our economic development toolkit, if you will, and looking really at what type of businesses the community is really looking for. And again, a lot of this work started with the EDC. And I think this was probably back in December. We surveyed what other grant programs were out there, brought that back to the EDC for review. As part of the budgeting process, the EDC did identify a request for $150,000 related to three business development grant programs. The first of which I'll cover is a revised restaurant grant. That's a grant that this board is familiar with and we've had in the Village for a number of years. The revised program is targeted at growing the Village's dining options and provides up to $50,000 in reimbursement, and that's one-to-one reimbursement to open a new restaurant. And the catch there is recipients would have to be required to install at least $25,000 in eligible improvements. Those eligible improvements are identified in the paperwork that's in the packet. The other piece is the retail business build-out grant. There was a lot of discussion at the EDC on this, and in particular what that minimum level of eligible improvements would be. I think we had a couple revisions back and forth. But overall, this retail business build-out grant program is targeted at strengthening retail business activity in the Village's shopping districts by attracting new retail businesses and assisting existing retail businesses in expanding their retail growth initiatives. Recipients would be eligible for reimbursement up to 50% of the costs incurred to locate or expand a business within the Village, and this would be a cap of $15,000 per business. Participants must have a sales tax generating business and must again install $5,000 worth of eligible improvements. The third grant program is the rehabilitation of a shopping center, a multi-use retail grant program. Again, the shopping center retail grant program is targeted at enhancing our existing retail sector. So this would not be for any new strip centers or anything newly built. This would be for recipients for this grant would be eligible for reimbursement up to 50% of the costs incurred for a rehab of a commercial shopping center or a mixed-use retail building with two or more tenants, and capped at $50,000 for reimbursement. Again, these items are brought forward through the EDC, and staff is happy to answer any questions. We have budget allocation in the realm of $150,000 for this new business development grant program. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
So let's start with public comment. Any public comment regarding this item? Seeing none, any board members have any questions?
I had a couple of questions. The restaurant grant program, so this would then replace our existing program that we have in place?
Correct.
And would this be limited to one restaurant per year, or could multiple restaurants use it?
Well, again, it depends. I think there, I think it would have to be that minimum amount of $25,000, and then we would match at 50%. So just assume somebody did the minimum amount, that would be matched at 50%, and then you'd have that much less to work with. So it could be, it couldn't be a lot of restaurants, and it depends upon the types of improvements that would take place.
Okay, thank you.
And this would be applied for on an ongoing basis throughout the year?
Correct.
It's not limited to one application period for everybody?
Correct.
So again, I'm asking you to repeat. I'm sorry.
That's
but
okay.
This now would be in the village's budget independently of the hotel motel tax fund. It would have nothing to do with that in terms of funding these grants.
So this fund, this is account is Fund 39. So that is the hotel motel.
These grants would be funded by hotel
yes.
motel.
Yes, as the current restaurant grant is
okay.
as well.
What is the philosophy behind the dramatic difference in the cap on the retail business versus the cap on the restaurant?
Just by the fact, and as we talked to some of the smaller retailers that opened in downtown, you know, that little extra couple thousand would have helped them get over a hump a lot easier than it would be for a restaurant that's got a lot of capital investment on that, especially when you're converting a space. There's a lot more expense related to that. I don't know, the build out versus a retail and a restaurant space. Mike, can you maybe comment on that? That's really how we came up with those caps and differences.
Because of the related mechanical, electrical, and plumbing improvements associated with restaurants, typically restaurant buildouts do have a higher cost to perform than a retail buildout that may not have as many plumbing, mechanical, and electrical improvements.
I don't have an example, but what if there were a retail business with a significant sales tax benefit, were they to come, that just by the nature of the particular unique business we're talking about did have more capital improvement needs to start up. I guess I'm asking, could the retail one be a little bit more flexible in the event that an opportunity arises that's not a restaurant but does require significant capital expenditure to start up? It's just a thought.
Erica, I had a question. Is it possible for different businesses to combine these grants? For example, if it was retail business that was coming in, but it would also be rehabbing our existing shopping center?
Usually with a shopping center, unless that particular business owner owned the shop or that particular business and the building itself, I think that could possibly, they could bring it forward so they could say, look, as part of this program, you know, I've I bought a strip center, and mm-hmm. I want to bring my business in, and I want to apply for a facade grant to improve the facade, the signage, all that stuff. But then I'm also bringing in a retail store as well that I'm going to own. I own the building and the business. Under that circumstance, they could probably apply for both for, again, EDC recommendation and board consideration. I think we would probably bring both of those applications forward.
I think the intent there was the shopping strip mall grant is for a minimum number of storefronts before they can apply for that. So it's multiple stores that are eligible for an improvement out in front, whereas right. the retail grant is for an individual business.
Right, it's two or more tenants.
Right. Can I just clarify?
Sure.
My understanding was the shopping center multi-use rental grant program would be for pre-existing strips, or would it be for purchasing?
It wouldn't be for the purchase. It would be towards the improvement.
Improving of pre-existing ownership.
Our current build-out.
So the only caveat to what I think trustees Sadat is saying is that perhaps if someone who owned the strip center then wanted to revamp one of the units, could they? Is that what the question is?
No, it was more a combination of the two different types of grants that a particular business who also owned the shopping center would be able to apply for.
Okay.
So kind of giving them a considerable leverage on the amount of funding that they could apply for from the village.
I think that if they were the owner of record of the
right.
space and they
yeah.
were the tenant in within their own space of 50% of it, they would technically comply with both or be right. eligible for both.
Do we have any shopping centers that fit that scenario?
That are owned by I'm sure there are.
We have one, I think, being built, right, Mike? That's the
one that was approved for construction at
right.
Ogden and Lacey
right.
would be an owner-occupied
right.
strip mall.
Yeah.
So that was the only one that I remember.
That wouldn't be eligible because it's new construction.
I'm not familiar with any existing strip malls
right.
that are.
So I don't think of any.
I couldn't think of any.
Just that one new one.
But right. but it could be a possibility. And ownership changes all the time. So.
Right, right.
So under new construction, you're not eligible for this? Is that what I just understood?
Right, not for the rehabilitation of a shopping center or multi-use retail grant program. Not for that one.
Okay.
But you could be eligible for a retail business build-out grant. Is that correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Or a restaurant.
Or right, restaurant, yeah.
So this would hopefully encourage people to utilize some of the empty spaces rather than new construction.
And I think that was a big objective of the EDC when they looked at that, is to improve our existing stock that we have.
Mm-hmm. The only other question I would have about it would be during the restaurant program. That's per business, not per storefront. Like, so if you had a restaurant that wanted to come in and utilize in a strip area, three or four storefronts, they're not suddenly eligible for $100,000 in grant because they're doing several storefronts.
No, and I would say they would be limited, and that'd be primarily they'd fall into the restaurant grant portion that caps you at $50,000.
Okay.
I just had a couple comments. I think that when we're talking grants, the amount of the grant should be dependent on the amount of the investment in the business. You know, for example, if somebody is building a new business, a restaurant, the amount of the grant, if they're going to construct a building and spend, you know, several hundred thousand or $1 million on the new business, that the grant should be dependent on the amount should be dependent on how much they're investing in Lyle and into our town. So if somebody's just taking an existing business and you know, putting in $15,000, you know, they shouldn't qualify for a $50,000 grant if someone else is building a, you know, brand new building. So it should be commensurate with the amount of the investment. The other thing I have an issue with is the funding for these grants, you know, where the money comes from. And as of right now, you know, we still have the LCVB that we haven't finalized the contract for, and the LCVB is, you know, seeking funding for the operation. You know, they've been doing work for the village and promoting our convention and tourism for the last 20 plus years, and they're in limbo right now. I know they're trying to get an agreement finalized. So I think it's kind of putting the cart before the horse as to what we're going to allocate to this, if we're going to allocate funds from our budget or if we're going to allocate from the hotel motel tax. I think there's some serious issues that exist right now. The law has, as of right now, has not changed, but it looks like you know, the law, there's some legislation out there to have a percentage of the hotel motel tax go to areas other than conventions and tourism. If that's the case, you know, to allocate certain amount to maybe a certain amount of the hotel motel tax can be allocated to a hotel, to a restaurant grant or a retail grant. But the fact is that, you know, we need to deal with the LCVB because they're out in limbo right now. I know the board recently met and is very concerned about the status of the LCVB going forward, as well as getting the funding that it needs to operate. I know that there's been requests made. We've kind of kicked this can down the road for you know, now it's over 6 months. The contract has expired, so we need to deal with that issue as well. And I'm all for giving grants and having a grant program, but we need to determine what the funding's going to be, where the funding's going to come from, and we need to, you know, we need to deal with our existing entities that are out there that are promoting our tourism, our conventions to the village, our hotels in the village. Otherwise, we're going to lose. We have three great hotels here in the village. We're going to lose one or more of our hotels if we're not, you know, fostering our conventions and tourism here in our village.
Thank you. Any other comment?
Yeah, I have a couple more questions. And this springs forward a little bit from Trustee Carballo's remark about this being commensurate with investment allowed. Is there an ROI component of these grants? You know, a business that would be projected to generate a certain amount of sales tax and property tax versus another type of business, would the one be eligible, more eligible than the other, an ROI?
That's not part of the current qualifications or evaluation. It's based on the investment in the improvements.
And is there any sort of clawback on this?
In some of them, particularly the restaurant and the shopping center, I think there's a five-year vesting period. And I think with the retail, we have to see a lease of a minimum of 3 years.
So where I sit right now, I have these three issues that I'm struggling with. One is assuming that no retail venture would be as worthy as a restaurant venture in getting the amount of grant funds. Not only worthy, but experience the same sort of capital hurdle to starting their business in Lisle. The issues of ROI and clawback, I feel, could be honed in this.
So along those lines then, so let's say we do have a restaurant that opens up and we give them the grant amount, say they go out of business in 2 years. They go out of business, that means they have no money. How would we get any of the money back or anything returned? How does that work?
The money would be, we would have to work with them on that. They have to repay the grant amount.
What if they declare bankruptcy?
Do we have lien rights on the equipment installed?
We would work those issues out probably in an agreement with the recipient. I don't know if the...
Beforehand? Before? Okay. Because after the fact, that we stuck holding the bag, basically.
Yeah.
If you were a business that provided service rather than retail, is there a place in this grant program for a shoe shop, a cleaner's?
The requirement is sales tax generation.
So you could be a complementary business as a service provider, but there really isn't an incentivizing program to incentivize services. Those businesses may generate additional foot traffic, an accountant, a doctor's office, things like that. But we want to incentivize sales tax producing businesses.
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole point of all this.
And specifically in the restaurant, I just want to go back to Trustee Hasse's question. Grant recipients must sign an agreement with the village promising to refund any unvested amounts and granting the village a lien against the benefited property or other form of security for any portion of the unvested amount that the grant recipient fails to refund to the village.
Okay, so they would be signing an agreement. Would that agreement have enough teeth in it for us to retain or get our money back?
Could we ask for a bond in the amount of the grant?
You know, we've asked for that in the past, and that has been a struggle for some of the businesses to do that. So, some of the concerns we've heard. So, you know, we've got to get $5,000 to get $5,000. So, those are just some of the hurdles with the bond issue or other surety that we've run into that we've heard staff heard from a concern from those grant recipients.
Eric, can I ask a question regarding your research on this particular situation where the grants, my philosophy of grants is that we're encouraging businesses to come here, not discouraging them. We're encouraging them, we're helping them bring their business to Lisle. And what we're looking for are larger businesses at this point. You know, in the past, our grants were smaller. And I think that going back to our January meeting, that was one of the leading factors of why this was being developed, is that we wanted to be able to offer the businesses a partnership to making them successful. And I see this contract doing that. I don't see anything else from what I'm seeing. Is that this is encouraging people to come, and that's what our motivation was. The clawback, I don't know how we can impose a clawback for a small business owner. I don't know how that could work. I can understand it from a bigger business, but for a small business owner, I don't know how we could put that in effect.
It's just as challenging from a big business as well.
Right.
Big businesses
have
more.
But I think that they're accustomed to it as opposed to a family-owned restaurant wanting to come to Lisle. That's what I would think, that more of a small business owner would want. The stipulations that we do have, the constraints and the paybacks, if things go badly for a business owner, if the economy goes badly, there are a lot of other factors that can take effect, but I think the amounts that we have are appropriate, because we're not looking at, these grants are intended for, again, seed money to help support the new venture. That's how I see this program working. And coming from the hotel motel tax dollars seems to be the right avenue. I think that Eric is working with the different areas to come up with the solutions of how we do this. Am I wrong, Eric, with your collaboration with the EDC and?
Right, no, we've been in talks with the LCVB and discussions and talking about the new economic development partnership and how that would look, yes.
Yeah, so I think that this would be encouraging. I mean,
And the goal in all this is, in this new development corporation, is to get private funding as well, private contributions to build these incentives, not just the hotel motel funds.
Right.
So we can have more to work with. I also want to clarify whether any of this precludes sales tax sharing agreements in addition to capital improvements. If it is the right kind of sales tax generating opportunity, can, just like the facade improvement and a build out improvement for a single entity, can a sales tax sharing agreement be piggybacked in that toolbox as well?
I think it could. Again, I don't know that anything would preclude this type of effort with, I mean, there's certain criteria in state statute where a sales tax sharing agreement you've got to meet, and a lot of it is the property focused. So we want to make sure that the state statute is followed there. But I don't think this program would preclude a sales tax sharing agreement.
But it almost kind of walks into that. If it's a vacant property and someone wants to come in and improve the facade of a strip mall, wants to improve an individual tenant space, and also is coming in with a big sales tax generating opportunity, that they could be rewarded multiple ways up front for the improvement and pay as you go as your business builds, and incentivize them to have a successful business to capitalize on further incentive.
As far as private funds, you're not going to get private funds donated to for restaurant grants or other business incentives. So I don't see that as being feasible. As far as sales tax sharing agreements, I think more for when you're talking about developments like a Marquette project or development of the Family Square property, that kind of thing, you're going to probably look more for a sales tax sharing than a grant, like a restaurant type grant. They're going to look more for that, or they're going to look for a TIF, because the amount of incentive is going to be, again, based on the amount of the investment, and that's going to be a multi-million dollar project. So talking about a $50,000 grant, that's basically non-incentive for those types of projects, or shopping center, that kind of thing. But for the for a restaurant, there is an incentive. A grant is an incentive, but the question is, what is the basis of the grant? Is it based on the amount of the investment, and how much are we going to give, for a restaurant to come into Lisle? If they're going to put in a lot of money to either rehab an existing structure or to build a new structure, that should be the criteria, I think, for the amount of the grant, because you know, if that restaurant goes out of business, you still have the structure, you still have the you know, the building or the improvements in the building that that will exist for whoever comes, you know, behind them. But you know, the question though is where the funds are going to come from, and you know, how much is going to be available in this you know, in this grant program, and where it's coming from, and how that's going to impact the hotel motel tax and the Convention and Visitors Bureau. So I think we're kind of putting the cart before the horse. I think we need to address the LCVB and future funding of the LCVB and you know, what they can live with under their budget versus how much would be left over for doing these kind of grants, or where we would get the money. You know, I don't think you're going to get it from private funds. We're going to have to give some kind of incentives, either a tax incentive, or if we're going to give a grant, it's going to have to come from a you know, from our existing funds, whether it's capital funds or some other funding, you know, diverting some of the funds towards an incentive program, a grant incentive program, with, you know, some hotel motel tax, if that would be feasible. But I think we need to evaluate where the money's going to come from before we even decide on, you know, what the program is going to be.
Well, I think the toolbox here, the grant program, is scalable depending on the budget. We just have to figure out, set the ground rules, and scale it as the budget allows. If we have a smaller budget than anticipated, we scale it down. If it grows larger, we expand it. But we need to set the groundwork.
I would agree with that. I'd rather have my tools ready for an anticipated project rather than have a project and be scrambling to put the tools in place. But so here's an example of what I was trying to get at before. I think I'm, you know, I'm not an expert in the restaurant business, but if there were two similarly sized venues, and one was a fine dining white tablecloth venue, and the other one was fast casual or even fast food, it would seem to me that the fine dining, because of the higher pricing, would by definition generate more sales tax revenue. And it would also seem to me, because of the capital items necessary to run a restaurant operation, that the capital expenditure to launch might be similar. I might be wrong, but I'm just making some assumptions. And therefore, I find myself feeling like the grant should be somewhat based on projected sales tax revenue, not just on the startup capital.
We don't have a way to really track that sales tax contribution unless we enter into a sharing agreement through some, but that has specific requirements, like Village Manager Ertmod mentioned. We only have certain criteria available to offer sales tax sharing agreements. That's the only way that we know what a private entity generates. So it's challenging to understand that.
Yes.
The other point I'd like to make is that we have to be cognizant of the fact that many, many, many improvements are fixture improvements and not capital improvements. When you build out a restaurant space, you put drains in the floor, but the sinks oftentimes are movable fixtures. And if it's financed, the finance company comes in and repossesses the fixtures, the ovens. You're left with the gas pipe in the wall, but the oven is gone. The hood may stay, and that may be the capital improvement, but we can't confuse fixture improvements, tables, chairs, with capital improvements, which is walls, dividers, things like that. And nowadays, whether it's retail or restaurants, everybody wants a simple layout. Everybody wants polished concrete floors and open ceilings as opposed to high finishes. So there isn't a whole, there isn't as much capital improvement as there is fixture improvement.
Well, I was using the term capital in a more accounting sense, that anything that costs is enough that per your internal policy, you capitalize it, you depreciate it. That's how I was using the word capital.
So maybe we should understand in the policy what we intend capital to be. Is it fixed improvements, or is it capital fixtures that could be repossessed by others?
Is that clearly defined, Eric? I seem to have read that it is.
So we have an eligible improvements section. Improvements include but are not limited to labor and material for tenant build out. All fixtures must be permanent. Permanent physical improvements to interior of the building and permanent physical improvements to exterior facade of a building, including signage.
I kind of equate this to one of our newer build outs for restaurants, the one that we had given a grant and an extension to. Again, when I'm looking at this proposal, I'm thinking about how have we capitalized on some of the businesses that we could have gained and offered them more assistance. Also found out a little bit more about what their true needs are. For example, the example you gave, a fine dining restaurant versus a fast food restaurant. The installation of the piping and the heating that would go in, the wheelchair access, the handicapped access entry points. All of those would have to be accounted for if they were turned from a strip mall retail establishment to a restaurant, whether they are a fine dining restaurant or a fast food restaurant. So those fixed costs, I believe, are what this grant is kind of working towards or with. That's my interpretation, and I think it seems clear to me, but...
But see, that's exactly my point, that there's a bigger return on investment from the same investment. There's a bigger return
You're
for
right,
the same investment.
You're right, but not everyone. It's about location, too. So if you do have a restaurant in an ideal location and a real someone that wants to open a hat shop instead, then they have to convert all that right back.
Something so to is. Consider... That greatly affects revenue in any business. Some of our best restaurants around town are closed one or two days a week, and they're such a high caliber restaurant they have the flexibility to do that. Whereas other restaurants need to operate longer hours, more days a week. Some of our restaurants are only open for breakfast and lunch, so it's hard to judge what the contribution will be based solely on their cost of construction. They're prorating the cost of construction over their business hours and their labor costs and everything else. And if they choose to work shorter shifts and fewer days, they're going to generate less revenue. But we really don't have that as an evaluation tool. No way to judge that. We're approving a restaurant. We're not approving their hours of operation.
We're not approving their cuisine. We're not approving their business. We're saying, yes, come convert this building to what you would like to envision.
And to reply to a question asked earlier, one of the better examples that I can think of a building that would probably qualify for multiple levels of these grants would be the old Bank of America building on Main Street, where Bank of Ottawa bought the entire building, divided a portion out for their use, left a majority for two or three other tenants, some of which could be a restaurant. So they could have applied for the multiple storefront grant. They could, had they been sales tax generating, they could have applied for bringing their business into their own space. and then a restaurant could have applied for build-out of a restaurant space in the remainder of it, and they could have piggybacked three opportunities there to build out there. Now, we don't have this in force, and they're already done. Now they're an existing building, so things change, but that's the best one I can think of. Stillens, if the building's owned by the same ownership as the proprietor, they may have an opportunity there if they ever wanted to do something. Just depends on how things fall in ownership adds into it. So,
is the Fox restaurant similar? Like there's three.
Fox restaurant would probably be similar as well. So at least they're tools in our toolbox, mm-hmm. and the budget decides the scale. But these are the working rules for it. So I think we've commented enough, and I think we've heard the same responses multiple times. Is there anything new to add by anybody?
Can I just ask one more question?
Sure.
How would this be promoted to the businesses? How would we get this out there?
So at a minimum, we'd have it on our website, and we'd talk with the EDC about promotion. I think there's a few commission members that would like to get the word out, so we'll strategize with the EDC about promotion of these.
Thank you.
What is the earliest that we can apply for these grants?
So there is budget allocation. There is $150,000 in the budget for these types of grants. The Village Board on June 3rd would have to approve a resolution formally adopting these guidelines, and then we would get the word out, and then people could start as soon as the board formally approved the guidelines.
Okay, so with having LCVB and the contract still in the works, would that hamper any of these applications as they're coming through, or would we have enough funding for this?
Like I said, there's currently $150,000 budgeted in Fund 39 for these grant programs.
Okay. Thank you.
In a related topic, and maybe it's an opportunity to discuss it in another workshop or another committee of the whole, do we have any programs, or have we considered any programs for any kind of cooperative advertising for new businesses that start up, where we can offer them cooperative advertising between the Village of Lisle and maybe two or three other businesses that we can get some airplay, radio play, things like that? I've been noticing the past couple of years, the Arboretum specifically, there's red announcements on the radio about the Lego program, Lego event at the Arboretum, but never once is Lisle mentioned. It doesn't say Lisle. Maybe we can incentivize other entities to add the word Lisle, add the Village of Lisle, add some, or stay in Lisle as a tagline with an incentive, and maybe it's another tool to add to the toolbox, but maybe it's a topic for further conversation. I think if a business is opening up, that cooperative advertising may be something that helps them out in the long run. So with that, any other board member comments, questions? May I have a motion to direct staff to prepare resolutions approving grant program guidelines?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
I just want to say I think it's premature based on the questions that were raised. I think it's good to have a program, but I think we need to figure out funding and I think the guidelines need to be better addressed here. I think this is a good first draft, but I don't think this is I think there's a lot of improvements that could be made with these guidelines as well.
Thank you very much. All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed?
No.
No.
Motion carries. Moving on, public officials and staff comments. Does a member of the Village Board have any comments? Let's go around the dais this direction, this thing.
Nothing for me.
Trustee Quetzal?
Again, just... my compliments and thanks and appreciation for all the work the EDC and staff and the attorney and everybody involved in these incentives did. This is really, really much improvement here.
Trustee Carvalho?
I just have a couple of comments. One is the LCVB, and I know there's some people from the LCVB who are here tonight. I think that we need to get the contract with the LCVB finalized and approved. I don't think it's fair to our staff and the board of the LCVB who work very hard for Lisle and are promoting Lisle and have done so for 20 plus years to not have their contract finalized and approved. And this has been a big burden for the staff at the LCVB, not knowing what their status is, what the future is of LCVB, as well as for the hotels. I've spoken to the owners as well as the general managers of our hotels in Lisle. We've got some, as I said before, we've got some great hotels here in Lisle. We've excellent brand hotels. All three of our hotels have been newly remodeled and are in great shape. And if we don't finalize this contract with the LCVB, I know I'm afraid, and I know they've expressed that one or more of these hotels will probably go out of business in the next few years because they don't have the staff and people from the LCVB who have been working for them over these years. The other comment I wanted to make is I think it's very important that we do promote our businesses and our property, our business properties in Lisle. The ownership of property is in Lisle. These people are trying to develop their properties and work to better the village. And I think it's appalling when I hear about someone who contacts the assessor and tries to get an owner of property in downtown Lisle to get their property assessed at a higher value. I think that's appalling. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Trustee Carvalho. Trustee Hasse?
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
Trustee Sadat?
I just want to take some time for the two residents that did come up today with their properties that are in the floodplain area. It is very, very close to heart when it comes to losing a home and coming up with avenues of making sure that you're able to reside there. So again, I would just recommend that they reach out to the village staff and see whatever that they can do in helping them.
Thank you. Trustee Wins?
I spent a little time here in the office this week and with some people from the LCVB, and I was encouraged by what it sounds like. Things are going forward. It seemed like they were encouraged to look at things in a new way. It seems like there's other communities doing similar things with economic development, and I'm excited to see what they have to say about it, and where it goes in the future. I think we're coming up with some good plans to help promote economic development in Lisle, and I think we're going to be doing it with the LCVB from what it sounds like to me. So I look forward to that, and I'd also like to reiterate what Sarah was saying. The people with the flood, they're feeling forgotten, it seems, and I just I appreciate that, we're giving them an opportunity to come up and voice their opinion on it. I hope they're able to get the results that they need from us. I don't know what else to do. I feel for them so much. It's a tough situation that land isn't getting any higher. So if we can just keep them as informed as we can about the going on with the Army Corps of Engineers and stuff, I'm happy to go and reach out to them and extend any anything I can to help them. So that's all I have.
Thank you, Trustee Wins. I'd like to close this with just a comment. I've noticed, I believe there are a new contractor, Beery Landscape, spending an awful lot of time cleaning up medians, gardens in the village, commuter lots, as well as Ogden Avenue, mowing a lot of the lawns and everything. It looks much, much improved. I know last year I spent a day driving around with Jason and Eric identifying state property, county property, and as Trustee Carballo said, if there's county property along Yackley or any of these other, I know Warrenville Road's always a challenge, Route 53 is a challenge, identifying these areas and asking for contribution from those other taxing bodies. We've taken it upon ourselves to do some of these, the Clover Leaves interchanges all along Ogden Avenue. And I think it's starting to show. We cut back some of the brush on St. Joseph's Creek along Ogden Avenue Bridge. But I did notice Beery putting forth a good effort, and hopefully they come up with some good garden baskets for Main Street to top it all off. That said, any village staff comments? Okay. I'd like to ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Clerk Turner, please take the roll.
Trustee Wins?
Aye.
Trustee Carballo?
Aye.
Trustee Kowitzel?
Aye.
Trustee Dixit?
Aye.
Trustee Hasse?
Aye.
Trustee Sadat?
Aye.
Mayor Pisak?
Aye. And we are adjourned for the evening. Thank you all.